Let's go to Washington, D.C., where Zack Ford is standing by. He writes for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. We had dinner 2 weeks ago in New York with my daughter. We finally met in person.
We did. It's been a long time coming.
Yes.
I was not surprised by anything.
Yeah. You know what? It's interesting. I was watching Julian Assange kicking and screaming, being arrested, not trying to get his way with a woman. And I thought, well, the first time I met Zack Ford was back in 2012 when you were explaining Chelsea Manning and solitary confinement. It seems so recent. All this stuff seems so new and current, and it's been going on for close to 8 years, the Julian Assange story and WikiLeaks and Chelsea Manning. And I guess Chelsea Manning served something like 8 years in prison? Something like that.
It was not an insignificant amount of time.
Yeah, yeah. And was put back in solitary recently. Anyway, you and I have been talking.
We should say for refusing to testify about her experiences and being held in contempt, right? This is a new situation for her.
Yeah, yeah. And it was Obama who had her locked up. The point I'm making is we've known each other for close to 8 years, and we finally met in person. And I brought my daughter along, who loves you, and you and my daughter made fun of me throughout the entire evening, and that was fun. Now, I think I'm funnier than my daughter, don't you?
I mean, what amused me was that you almost walked into that dinner with the perception that I would be on your side and somehow help, like, gang up on your daughter. And that was immediately disproven. Immediately.
I'm very competitive with my children. I have to be the funniest. She is pretty amazing.
She's pretty great.
Yeah, she was pretty great. All right, let's hopefully we'll... I'm planning some trips to Washington, D.C. My table manners were okay. I didn't embarrass you?
As far as I can recall, yeah.
Okay. All right. Let's talk about Mayor Pete from Indiana. South Bend, I believe, right?
That's correct.
He's running for president. And also from Indiana is a man named Mike Pence, no fan of the LGBTQ community. As a matter of fact, his wife teaches at a school, you've written about this, that not only bans LGBTQ students, I believe they ban their parents. So what's going on between Mayor Pete and the vice president, because the vice president insists he's cool with Mayor Pete.
Right. So this is an interesting situation where you have the competing values of needing to work together with someone who stands opposed to you. And so the reason that we're hearing about Pence and Buttigieg together is the fact that South Bend is in Indiana and Pence was governor of Indiana. And so governors and mayors have to, you know, figure out how to work together to support the people that they represent. But of course, Pete Buttigieg is gay, now has a husband, and Pence stands against all of that, mm-hmm. all of it. And so, you know, Buttigieg, of course, has to talk about the fact that, you know, that Pence has these positions, that Pence tried to pass this religious freedom law in Indiana that would have allowed for discrimination. And of course, you know, Pete Buttigieg has said he's capable of working with Pence, but of course you have to draw that line and say this person rejects who I am and what I believe in. And what's been really interesting, and this is not new in a sense, but both Karen and Mike Pence have responded to this by taking umbrage, right? They say, oh, it's just such a shame that Mayor Pete has to attack us for our faith. And that is not what is happening, right? Mm-hmm. What is happening is that they have beliefs that are in fact harmful to other people, right? If you say, I don't think that same-sex families should have the same rights, or that queer people should not be able to walk into the same spaces and have the same access to things. You are hurting people. And why I say this isn't new is because the Pences are always trying to avoid taking accountability for what they actually believe. They downplay it, or they distort it, or they try to water it down in a way to suggest that, like, there's nothing problematic about their beliefs. And there very much is. So I think it's interesting that they're willing to kind of keep responding in such a way. I think they're actually really sensitive about it, because this has come up, you know, every time we talk about Mike Pence's history of supporting conversion therapy, when we talk about in relation to also the sort of HIV epidemic that he allowed for in Indiana by, you know, opposing needle exchange in regards to the opioid epidemic. A lot of things that he's really responsible for, and he doesn't want to have to be held accountable for it. And so he, you know, obfuscates. He totally tries to turn it back on the person who's making the claim. But the reality is that they're anti-gay. They just are. And I don't think there's anything problematic about the way Pete Buttigieg is calling it out.
Yeah, and the mayor brought up his Christian faith and threw it in Mike Pence's face.
Exactly. You know, my former Think Progress colleague Jack Jenkins is fervently concerned with, you know, helping the religious left get the voice that it deserves in the media, because too often conservative religious belief is highlighted as speaking for all people of faith. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Pete Buttigieg is somebody who has faith and practices it and identifies with it and incorporates it into his gay identity. And for a lot of people, that is revolutionary, right? Like, that is anathema to Southern Baptist belief in particular. But, you know, for a lot of people, it makes perfect sense that their faith informs them to be affirming of LGBTQ people. And so I think it's interesting how Mayor Pete is really, you know, poking this thing that we don't really talk about very much. And he's not the only candidate who's, you know, speaking about their faith from a liberal perspective. But I think because religious issues have been so tightly intertwined with LGBTQ issues, it's resonating in a very different way. And certainly all the more so because of the Pence's reactions.
With Pence, you get a sense that this isn't political. He genuinely hates the LGBTQ community. Is that a fair assessment?
I try to be careful when I use the word hate, because the implications of it are hateful, and certainly when you're in a position of power and espousing those sorts of beliefs, it can inspire hate. It's always hard to accuse an individual as opposed to an organization of personally espousing hate, because for a lot of people, they do sincerely believe what they say about queer people. And so you have to sort of meet them there and say, okay, you have this belief, but just because you believe it's true doesn't mean that there aren't consequences or implications that you personally are responsible for, because you're the one espousing it and you're the one acting on behalf of it. So it's this challenging thing where you have to say, okay, this is, you feel that this is a core part of who you are. Can we just start by talking about that? And what does that mean? And what does that look like? And then do you understand what the consequences of that are for other people?
And does Mike Pence understand the consequences?
I think
he does.
Oh, well,
I think he does. I think he's just hateful.
You know, it's a tough call to make. I think there's the difference between whether he believes that it will do harm versus whether or not he thinks it's still better to preserve the things that he believes that he's protecting. So I'm being intentionally a little messy in talking about it, because I think that it informs the way we need to have conversations with other people in our lives. We can't just say, oh, you're hateful, because that immediately puts up walls and it doesn't allow us to have the conversation. I, you know, at this point, it's hard to be forgiving in any way of Mike Pence, because he's made so many big decisions that hurt queer people on such a big public level that, you know, he would actually have to work to undo all of that to really achieve any sort of redemption. But I think in terms of just how we respond to people who espouse those kinds of beliefs, we have to meet them where they are to have that kind of conversation.
So Mayor Pete is running and his star is on the rise. People like me and some of my listeners are concerned that other than being great for the LGBTQ community, he's not that great for the 99%. There's an article that we both read. I think it was in Current
Affairs. I actually didn't read it. I found it obnoxious to be.
Okay. So there's an article in Current Affairs that everybody is working off of, accusing Mayor Pete of essentially being a neoliberal who went to Harvard, then on to McKinsey, and McKinsey Consulting is turning out to be one of the most evil companies in the world. They advise Purdue Pharmacy on how to smooth over their reputation for creating the opiate epidemic. That Mayor Pete may be an opportunist, according to this article, who's out of touch with the common man, that he is part of the elite, kind of like Obama. And if he gets elected, it'll be more symbolic, nice window dressing, as opposed to something substantial.
I mean, it's an interesting juxtaposition to say on one hand, you don't think that he's accomplished enough, or at least not at a high enough level, because most of his work has been, at least politically, as a mayor. And at the same time, say that you think he's out of touch with the common man, which is exactly what he does as mayor. So it's sort of funny to try to paint this narrative where he loses both ways. And that's why, like, I really struggled with that article and didn't really give it a lot of merit, is because here's somebody who is personally an ardent Bernie supporter who took the time to read Pete Buttigieg's memoir and dissect it and pull out all of the things that he found suspect. And I haven't read that memoir. And so to just take one person who has a clear bias on their perspective is not going to be helpful for me, particularly as someone who doesn't get into all of the juicy nonsense of horse race politics to begin with. So I think what you need to do is take a step back and think about, okay, why am I feeling so defensive about this one particular candidate who's on the rise? And recognize how other people are responding to that, how that's impacting the content that you're absorbing about him, and then just take a deep breath and say, look, we've got 20 some odd candidates who are running, and the more we learn about each of them, the more they have different sorts of interactions and go back on different issues, the more the race is going to change and our perceptions about them all are going to change. And we have to sort of keep in mind that everyone is going to affect everyone else. And I think I said this to you last time we talked about Bernie. Like, even though I personally have some concerns about Bernie and wasn't excited to support him in the primary, I was glad in 2016 that he was in the primary because he moved Hillary on some things and Hillary moved him on some things. And having that back and forth is important. And so what I see right now is there was a whole lot of momentum for Pete Buttigieg, right? A whole lot of sudden mainstream appearance and visibility and awareness, and a very sharp backlash to that in the form of this one particular article that kind of hit on all of the things that people were like, oh, but he doesn't meet this criteria that I'm looking for, or in this case that I've already found in someone like Bernie. And that's okay, right? It's okay to sort of ask questions of a candidate and offer some scrutiny. But what you don't want to do is offer that scrutiny in such a way that you just dismiss the candidate right out the bat, because then you're just appealing to your own biases. You're saying, oh, I was tempted by this person who was different than somebody that I already supported, and now I have reason to dismiss that. No, I mean, really, you don't. What you're trying to do is satiate your own biases, but you really are reconciling the fact that every candidate has perfections and imperfections, and we're just trying to figure them all out and trying to figure out how best they'll all lead. And so I'm open to the conversation. I'm open to criticism of these different candidates. I'm not open to knock this guy down before he gets any farther, because that just reads as illegitimate.
Things have changed in how we view candidates, and I don't think it's because of Trump. I think it's because of Obama. We used to measure a candidate by that 3 a.m. phone call. Who do you want being awoken in the middle of the night? And it was all about character. And now I think character isn't as important as what you believe in. That, I think, is what the Bernie bros or the Elizabeth Warren supporters, that is the problem they have with all the other candidates. Somebody like Beto, who took out an ad, and I got this ad on the internet. It said, "What do you think is the most important issue? I'd like to hear from you. Tell me what you think I should think." That was literally an ad that I got from Beto. Now, again, I'm a Bernie supporter or an Elizabeth Warren supporter. And my first reaction to Beto was, this was my reaction, "How dare you? I want leadership. I shouldn't be telling you what you should believe in. You shouldn't be tofu. I shouldn't be projecting onto you what I think is right. You should be a leader and tell us what's important." So when you're looking for a candidate, just in general, we don't have to talk about Mayor Pete, but just in general, are you looking for character or are you looking for leadership? I think we're moving away from character and more towards leadership. Like, where are you going to take us? What do you believe in?
Well, you know, I think what you're speaking to is just how differently we think about candidates as we do actual leaders, mm-hmm. right? And likewise, the skill of campaigning is not the same skill as leading. And, you know,
Cuomo said politics is poetry, governing is prose.
Exactly. And, you know, I think we see in Trump and even in Trump's base exactly what it looks like when you have leadership in poetry. Mm-hmm. Right? Here's somebody who only cares about appealing to his base and, you know, regurgitating the same promises that he made in the campaign and making them his top priorities, as opposed to recognizing other issues or reacting and responding to things in a responsible sort of way. Mm-hmm. And so I think when you're thinking about whatever candidate you want to support, you have to remember the media environment in which you live and the way that you might feel about a candidate based on their stage presence or their rhetoric or even their positions. You still also have to examine what does their mind look like? How do they operate when faced with a challenge? And I'll toot my own horn a little bit here. Just before we went on the air, you were talking about how, you know, the beat that I cover has changed a little bit, and you're still sort of impressed with what I'm able to deliver. And I think that speaks to having a skill and being able to apply it in different contexts as opposed to just only having one narrow sort of focus. And so likewise, I think you need to look at candidates and say, okay, they totally get me on this issue, but when they're handed something that like is totally new to them or totally outside their normal MO, how do they handle it and how do they respond and how do I feel about their ability to react in thoughtful and timely ways? And I, you know, it's a hard thing to measure, particularly because we don't watch the ins and outs of the House and Senate that often, mm-hmm. Which is usually where a lot of our candidates come from, and in particular in this race of where a lot of them have come from. So it's a really challenging thing to think about the competing interests in your own head of
right.
who appeals to you versus who you think can actually, you know, be an effective leader.
Right. I want to ask you about Arizona in a second. But one of the things I'm beginning to realize about the presidency as it changes because of Trump and because of Obama is the 3 a.m. phone call. We were always told, who do you want getting that 3 a.m. phone call? Trump is the 3 a.m. phone call. He's actually up at 3 a.m. He's making the call and he's answering it and he's creating the international incident. So one of the things I like about Bernie is Trump is teaching me that, okay, what if What if we had a president who was making 3 a.m. phone calls and it was for good? And that, so I kind of like the idea of somebody like Elizabeth Warren or Bernie doing what Trump does, but in the light, doing it for good, not for, I have to say, evil. I mean, he's just pure evil, Trump. He's the devil. He is. I don't know why we have to nibble around this. I know you don't believe in the devil, but I think Trump is the devil.
Well, I certainly think that Trump has a lot of fascist tendencies. I don't know that he's gotten us into full fascism yet, but I definitely feel like his motivation is his own power. And he's willing to throw anyone under the bus who he doesn't see as supporting that power.
Yeah.
And if you want to call that evil, I'm fine with that because it's hard to distinguish it from evil. But you know, it's, I think we still have to think about it in the same practical, right? It's that same poetry versus prose thing we were just discussing of like, it's, you can come up with a lot of creative ways of describing it, but how do you understand it and how do you respond to it? Those are the things that, you know, we're faced with so many ridiculous new scenarios,
right,
because of his leadership, that we have to figure out what is actually happening. How is it changing us as a country and changing our culture and our norms? And then how do we respond to that? How do we push back or you know, prepare to hopefully someday reset them and restore them to where they were?
Thank you for saying that. You just said something. What is really happening? Because part of the toolbox that a fascist uses is making us so confused that we don't know what is really happening. Every day, Trump creates something shiny that we have to pay attention to, and we get lost, and we don't know what his agenda is. I find myself right now thinking of two different things. One is, what is Trump doing? Is it real? And then I think about the 2020 elections. So I think a year from now, when maybe we can get rid of Trump. And when I focus on the presidential campaign, it's wishful thinking because Trump is hopefully being destroyed. And while I'm thinking about Bernie and the Democrats, he's quietly destroying the country. I mean, he's doing it quietly because we don't really see what the Interior Department is doing, what the EPA is doing in terms of blocking fracking. And, you know, he makes these big pronouncements, but underneath it all, there's some really dangerous stuff that he's allowing his bureaucrats to accomplish.
Yeah, that's exactly right. We won't know the full damage until sometime after. But in the meantime, we have to, you know, be vigilant. We have to not just say, oh, there's Trump being Trump again. It's like, no, really, what is he doing today? What is the impact? What is the motivation? How is he shifting our normal perceptions of things? And is that a good thing or a bad thing? And if it's a bad thing, how do we respond to it?
And what does he really want? You know, the issue with Russiagate, which I still happen to believe in, I believe in Russiagate. That's how I explain Trump, that he's bankrupt, he needs money, so he's indebted to the Russians. That explains the Trump administration to me. If it's not Putin, then what is his motivation? What is it? And you wrote about Stephen Miller, who's taking over the Trump White House. What do you think Trump really wants? And what is his management style? Why has Stephen Miller why has Stephen Miller been elevated? And what does that tell us about Trump?
Well, this is something that I ponder a lot, which is just like, what would it be like to be rich and to be able to get anything that I wanted? And even if Trump is not as rich as he claims to be, there aren't a lot of obstacles for him in terms of material possession to get specific things that he wants.
Oh, but before you hold that thought for one second, do you believe that he's worth at least $500 million.
Probably not.
Okay. I don't.
There's so much inflated rhetoric around his worth, and so many bankruptcies and unknown debts. It just, I think he definitely overinflates his worth.
So the Russia story. Hold that thought for 1 second. I apologize, but I just want to be clear here. The Russia story plays into the narrative. This was all a branding exercise. He needs money, and he's thinking 8 years from now when he's pushing 80, and he'll have all the money in the world because he will have been branded this president of the United States. That's how I explain his motivation, and that's why Russia falls into that narrative. But if that's not it, what if he's not broke? Then why is he doing it?
Right, and that's what sort of what I'm getting at is that, regardless of his financial situation, he still is positioned such that there isn't any big thing he would want that he couldn't get. And so you have to instead think about motivation in psychology. And this is where, you know, I do think that you have to be careful about sort of armchair diagnosing. But, you know, the arguments that George Conway makes, I think are illuminating, or at least should be part of the conversation, because it's not about necessarily what he wants, because it's not clear to me that there's like a thing that he could ever say, I got that and I'm done. It's what motivates him, what drives him, what direction does he feel that he should be taking the country based on the position that he's in. And that is a psychological thing, right? It's like, I've been empowered to do this. What then is my mission? Mm-hmm. And so I think, you know, as I was saying in my Stephen Miller piece, we have this group of white men who feel that their country is under attack because there's, you know, women are pushing back through the Me Too movement, and queer people are speaking out and owning their identities, and a whole lot of people are coming from other countries and finding opportunities to, you know, hold on to aspects of their culture while living in the United States. And for these fragile white men, they feel that that's an attack. They felt like they had a ubiquity of their culture throughout society, and the idea that they have to sacrifice that for others' benefit doesn't suit them. And so you have someone like Stephen Miller, who very much echoes Trump's leadership style, right? I don't think it's that surprising when you think about it, that someone so young, you know, he's 33, he's my age, is in this position of power, because since he was young, like in high school even, you know, he had this temperament of always provoking norms and always pushing for white men to maintain this sort of elite status. And that's exactly what I think is also driving Trump at the same time. And so they're kind of two peas in a pod. And, you know, I framed his administration as a reality show, because obviously that resonates with his past experiences. And, you know, Stephen Miller is somebody who knows exactly how not to get fired by Donald Trump, which is to say all of the things that he agrees with, to lead in all of the ways that he wants to lead, and to deliver something that is very appealing to Trump's base, which is generally all that he cares about. So it's this whole psychological thing of who are these people as white men in positions of power, and what do they think will help them maintain that kind of position of power, right? There's still a sort of survival instinct, even at that level, that drives them. And it's unfortunately the combination of what personally drives them also drives their base, which then drives them more. So there's sort of a cyclical property to it as well.
Mixed martial arts is one of the most popular sports right now. I don't enjoy watching it. However, there are grown men who spend an evening relishing the sight of two men in the octagon or two women in the octagon making each other bleed. I think when Stephen Miller and Donald Trump see mothers being separated from their children, they enjoy it. They probably don't acknowledge that they enjoy it to themselves.
I mean, there was an anecdote that someone in the White House literally said that when Stephen Miller started to see photos from the border, he was happy with what he saw.
Right.
Right. Yeah. And it, you know, think about the language that they used. They said, oh, we're going to impose this zero tolerance policy as a deterrent. Right. We want these people to feel like crap when they come to the border so that they know it was a mistake and they don't try to stay. Right. You don't have to think about it too hard to recognize, like, oh, right, their whole strategy is to create a negative experience for these people. So it shouldn't be a surprise that they're happy that that's what's happening, because that's their goal. That's the whole point of the policy.
You can't imagine the pathology of these people. I know three men who love Trump, and I know how they nibble around the edges, and they put cologne on their sulfuric thoughts, but I've been around them long enough and seen them with alcohol in their system, and they've revealed how hateful they are. And, you know, it's, you can't fathom the depths of self-hatred and contempt for humanity that these people have. They're just schooled in hiding it. They really are hateful. And I think the problem I have is I can't imagine looking at a mother being separated from her child or being put in a cage, seeing kids in a cage, and not thinking this is horrible. But there are people who get off on it. They get off on it. Some of them know they get off on it, and some of them are in denial that they're getting off on it, but they're getting off on it.
Well, I think that your denial of getting off on it speaks to really the most nefarious part of it, which is they don't realize that they've dehumanized these people. And right, we've seen this every single time there's been fascism come to rise, right? Like, how many German people were led to believe that Jews' lives were worth less? Worth less than theirs, but literally worthless in some cases too, right? But they didn't go into it thinking like, I hate Jews. They went into it thinking like, oh, I'm now beginning to understand this perception that's been presented to me that Jewish people are infringing upon the life that I thought I had as a German person, right? It's the same sort of propaganda effort to convince you to feel okay thinking about these human lives with lesser concern than you think about people in your own life. And right, you have to just remember, we're not evolving as a species in a literal way, right? We still have these reptilian brains that still have these fight or flight tribalist instincts. And despite how interconnected our world is, they can still easily be triggered. And I think that's really what's happening here, is this tapping into, you know, you feel like we've done everything right and we are on a moral high ground in terms of the kind of country that we've created for ourselves. And so somebody who's not following our laws, right, as they convince themselves, right, they're breaking immigration law by trying the way they're trying to enter, even though that's not true because asylum is legal,
right,
but and a civil right internationally. But, you know, it's this convincing like, oh, they're just not doing it the right way, so it's their fault. They deserve whatever's coming to them. It's actually this process of dehumanizing them, of not recognizing, well, like, they didn't have access to Wikipedia when they were fleeing gang violence in Central America, right? They're not like coming to this country because they've followed all of the procedures to the T and have access to all of the support that they would need to do that. They're just trying to like save their own damn lives and protect their families. And so they get here and we say, oh, well, you're not doing this properly and you're not acting like a real American. And so if you want to, you know, have access to all this great stuff that we've set up for ourselves, we clearly have demonstrated the best way to do that. And so if you're not following along, you don't belong. And but really what we're saying is you're not enough like us. You're too different. And so we reject you and we don't want to protect you. We don't want to give you safe harbor.
Right. before we talk about Arizona, put this through the LGBTQ prism for me. When you look at somebody like Stephen Miller, when you look at somebody like Donald Trump or Mike Pence, because Howie Klein, who does this show a lot, says that men who are in the closet are very sick. They're not in touch with who they are. And he talked about his period in the closet, and denying how you were born creates thousands of different side effects that are all pathological. So through the LGBTQ prism, if you look at somebody like Mike Pence or Donald Trump or Stephen Miller or Donald Trump Jr. and Eric, they're born a certain way. They are, I believe, sadists. I think they are cruel and mean and murderous, but they're in the closet. So it comes out in other ways. And I think that the LGBTQ community can offer insight into that, because so many people who are LGBTQ at one point in their life denied to themselves how they were born.
I mean, first of all, I would say I think you have to be taught to hate. So
I don't agree with you.
We'll just have to disagree on that, because I think that you can be instilled at a very subconscious level at a very young age with principles that resemble hate and that motivate you to make the kinds of decisions and pursue the kinds of positions that they have. But I think I have to believe that you have to be taught hate, because I need to be able to believe that you can be untaught hate. And that doesn't mean that I believe that every single person is redeemable, but that does mean that I have to continue to work to help people, as many people as possible, understand how what they believe is hurting other people, because otherwise it's all just a lost cause. And I know, because I've personally had conversations with people, that it is possible to unpack that way of thinking and get them more oriented toward a more affirming or at least less harmful position. Right. It is a spectrum, and it is work, and you have to recognize progress where it's made, but I have to believe any sort of degree of progress away from harm and away from hate is possible.
I agree. And I think that everybody is born with the potential to be hateful. And I think they're not necessarily taught to hate. I don't think sometimes certain people aren't corrected properly. Sometimes you'll see a child taking a hammer to ants, and the parent has to say, you're killing something, and they stop and they never do it again. Then there are people like Stephen Miller who won't stop hammering ants when they're 2 years old. I honestly believe Stephen Miller's parents did the best they could with him and said, stop killing ants. You're a Republican. Channel it into politics. Let it all come out in the public forum. And I think Trump's father taught him there were winners and losers and taught him how to hate, but he really cottoned to it. And I think that's the way he was born. I think he was born to hate. I think he was born to destroy everything he touches. And you can only rein him in. You can't change somebody like Stephen Miller or Donald Trump. You can teach them how to be polite, how to hide it. But in the end, they're irredeemable. Some people are irredeemable. I mean, like child predators, right? They can't be changed, can they?
I mean, I still fundamentally disagree with you, because I believe that there are any number of environmental factors that can reinforce and reward behavior in a way that fosters this kind of attitude. And particularly when you think about white men who have very sexist and racist views, it's not hard to see how that seed, once it's planted, can quickly grow. Because once you start saying, like, only white men should, you know, have positions of power or define culture for society, you're going to quickly hear from other white men who agree with you, and you're going to get reinforced in exactly the kind of thing that's going to set you down that path. But I still think that there are ways of rehabilitating people, and it might not be that, like, I'm going to turn, you know, Stephen Miller someday into an immigration lawyer who's fighting for people's asylum rights. Like, that's not my goal. Mm-hmm. But my goal would be to, like, try to help him see that other people's lives have value and that his actions have consequences in real people's lives. And he might be sociopathic, right? He might have been put down a path so far that there isn't a way for him to sort of uncheck that box in his brain and understand it. But I would still want to help him recognize that he can control his actions, and there will be people that will give him a different kind of support if he doesn't do some of these harmful things. Like, I still see a path for him to do less harm that I would want to work with him. That doesn't mean I'm, like, going to become a buddy or a champion for Stephen Miller, but I need to be able to believe that it's not permanent and that there's not any particular way that, you know, that harm could ever be reduced.
See, I think Christian Nielsen can be changed, or Sean Spicer could be changed. I don't think Stephen Miller can be changed. I think Christian Nielsen is an opportunistic lawyer who saw an opportunity and seized it and did the best she could without totally disgusting herself. She should be permanently pariahed in this country, but I think she could be redeemed. I don't think somebody like Stephen Miller or Donald Trump can be redeemed.
Well, it depends on what we're talking about in terms of what that word even means. Like, clearly Nielsen's capacity for tolerating, you know, torturing of other people was pretty damn high, mm-hmm. right? And so redemption for her has to look like her actually engaging in some truth and reconciliation. Like, I didn't understand, but now I do. This was wrong. This is how I'm going to work to right it. Like, there's a journey for her that she could take, but she has not taken a single step on it, despite all of these murmurings that, like, things got too far. Like, she needs to actually own that and do it herself.
You get the sense that it was ambition as opposed to Kellyanne, who's just diseased.
Lots of aspersions to cast here, and I totally sympathize with where they're all coming from. But, you know, like, to the point I said earlier, is if we just dismiss all of these people out of hand as, you know, irredeemable, or they're just always going to do this, and so what can you do, then we're not actually having the conversation about how do we resist them? How do we actually respond to the harm they're causing our country? And so, you know, there's always going to be Stephen Millers in the world, and they might not always, you know, be the worm tongue in the president's ear, but they'll still be out there. And we need to, like, think about these issues in a way where we're actually engaging with those people and either helping them find other priorities that aren't harmful to society, or actually unpack the harm that they're causing and learn to reconcile it. And if we're not doing that, then we're just actually letting them win. We're just sort of letting them run rampant because we're just saying, you're a lost cause. Right. And I can't get on board with that. As painful as it is, right? Like, I've been doing LGBTQ advocacy for over a decade, and, like, I've had a lot of tough conversations with people, and they didn't budge. But I'm still going to have that conversation with them in the future, and I'm going to have more conversations mm-hmm. with them after that. And I'm going to keep trying because someday there's going to be a queer kid in their community, and they're right. going to have to deal with that. And I want them to at least be prepared when new circumstances enter their lives that they've heard other experiences than just their own inner voice informing how they should react to the world.
Okay. We'll get to Arizona in a second. I was taking somebody to an orthopedic surgeon yesterday to help her deal with her back pain. And we talked about hatred, because you said hatred has to be taught. And one of the theories about back pain is that it's anger that hasn't been released. It's all pent up. And we were talking about hate and anger and rage and how it has to be channeled properly. So, you know, you met my daughter, and I told her at a very early age that hatred is something that can be very useful if it's channeled properly, and anger can be very useful if it's channeled properly. The most important thing is not to turn it on yourself or the wrong people. Just something to, what you said, hatred has to be taught, and I taught my kids that hatred and anger is natural, but you need to focus it creatively and at the bullies. There are enough bad people in the world that you can focus all your hatred towards. We'll never run out of bad people to hate and destroy.
You had a little caveat in there, and I think that that's the more important point, which is it's not just channeling anger and hatred in different directions. It's about recognizing when you're experiencing anger and hatred, and then choosing to respond to those feelings in a responsible way. And so I might use words like determination or grit or tenacity to describe how I would channel those. But like, I don't think being purely motivated by anger or hatred is actually healthy regardless of who you target, right? Like it's something that comes up in superhero movies all the time, like with the Hulk being perhaps the best embodiment of it. Like, is it good that, like, you know, he's always channeling it as anger? Like, no, because it's so easy for that to lose control. But if you can recognize, if you have enough self-awareness, be like, these are the emotions that I'm experiencing. What are they motivating me to do? Mm-hmm. Oh, they're motivating me to lash out in this way. Will lashing out in this way align with my principles or help me achieve my goals? No. Okay. Now, how can I translate that into something that will? And in the process of doing that, you are taking your anger and responding in an effective way as opposed to just redirecting it. I think that there's a difference there, and I would encourage people to think about taking that extra step of processing it and transforming it into something else as opposed to just pointing in a different direction.
Yes. Okay, last thought. I just found this article that is so funny about hatred. There's a comedian named Ron, I don't know if I'm pronouncing this properly, Ron Funches, and he has a new special out. And one of the things about comedy that I believe is that unless it's hateful and angry, it isn't funny. And my style of comedy, for the most part, is turning the hatred on myself. But I think you can't be funny unless you're being mean and vicious towards someone or something. That's just my theory about comedy. And the truly successful comedians are the ones who know how to disguise the hatred, so you don't even realize that you're laughing at something so reprehensible. That, to me, is my theory of comedy. And the better the comedian, the more they're able to disguise the hatred underneath. But there's a lot of hatred underneath. And I found this story in the Daily Beast that I wanted to talk about. This guy, Ron Funches, stand-up comedian Ron Funches, tells the Last Laugh podcast how Louis C.K.'s angry comedy helped inspire him to be positive. I never want to be the type of person, that old school, that old Louis C.K. comedy that's like, oh, my daughters and my wife, I hate them. And then he goes on to call Louis C.K. a piece of shit. So he's talking about, he just wants to be positive and upbeat. I don't want to be a piece of shit comic like Louis C.K. Well, you know, Louis has done some things that are pretty horrible, but you know, you're either positive or you're not. You can't be positive and call Louis C.K. a piece of shit.
Just to interrupt your theory a little bit there, I would encourage everyone to Google Tig Notaro pushes a stool. The entire bit is Tig Notaro pushing a stool across the stage, and it makes a squeaky sound. And she does it for quite a while.
Yes.
It's hilarious, and it does not come at anyone's expense.
Yes, it does.
It does not.
At the audience's expense. I know, Tig. I know exactly what she's doing. She's doing that to torture the audience. It's mean-spirited. It's saying, look, look how much time I can waste of yours. It's a hostile gesture.
But it's playing with expectations, and I don't think that that's the same thing.
No, that's a giant FU to the audience. That comes from a place of hatred. Hang on for 1 second. How much contempt do you have to have for humanity to push a stool in front of millions of people? It's so hateful.
I disagree, but we don't have to parse Tig's comedy.
All right, let's talk about what's going on in Arizona. What is this called?
So there are a handful of states, I think it's six or seven, that have what we've called a no promo homo law on the books. And what that means is you cannot promote homosexuality in the classroom. These are laws that specifically dictate limitations on sex education across the state. And each of them is a little bit different, but they all sort of speak to, you know, you either have to say that homosexuality is bad and harmful, or you're not allowed to mention it whatsoever.
Jesus.
And so we kind of put them all under this umbrella of you can't say anything affirming about homosexuality.
Mm-hmm.
And Arizona actually repealed theirs. There's not something that's talked a lot about, but they took it on and they were actually successful at getting it off the books. And as we're talking Thursday, I think the governor just approved it. So it's a weird little thing that is a relic of a past time, and yet it's still law in these states. It's still enforceable in these states, right? It's not like it falls under the umbrella of the sodomy laws or something like that, right? It's still very much enforceable. And we're in a world where we have visibility and sort of mainstream cultural understanding of who queer people are. And so we're going to have a lot of young queer people coming out, and we know that that's already increasing in frequency. So it's really important that we address this big obstacle, because we know that in schools, when you have a gay straight alliance, when you have a curriculum that includes LGBTQ people, when you have laws or bullying protections that enumerate sexual orientation and gender identity as protected classes from bullying, all of these things that are positive and affirming make schools safer and allow queer students to succeed to their full academic ability. And so we have to kind of approach all of these relics of the past and make sure that they're not obstacles to the future.
Great. All right, my friend, this was great. Thank you for this. I have a final thought.
Oh, that I'm going to have to respond to with another 10-minute discussion? Yes, go ahead.
Right. This is my final thought. Well, you tooted your own horn earlier, and it's true. You wrote this great piece about Stephen Miller, and my sister and I were reading it. Anyway, it's a great piece, and I'm going to toot my own horn. You met my daughter, right?
Yeah.
She's fantastic.
She was great.
She's fantastic. And you could tell that I'm terrified of her, right?
I could, yes.
I am corrected by her, and I trust her judgment, and I would never do anything to lose my relationship with my daughter. For example, I have these reading glasses that I wear around my neck, and sometimes when we're eating, if I'm having, say, toast and some crumbs fall on the reading glasses, it's as bad as genocide. And I know that if I want to have my daughter in my life, I have to be very mindful of my reading glasses while I'm eating so crumbs don't collect on them. This is why I blame Jenna Bush and Ivanka Trump, that they should be locked up. They should be brought up before The Hague. It is Ivanka's fault, and it is Jenna Bush's fault for the Iraq war. If I'm humming the Star Wars theme song out of tune, my daughter is ready to take a baseball bat to my head. I have to watch everything I do. And I know that Ivanka and Jenna had that power over their fathers, and they didn't use it. And I hold them responsible for their father's administrations. How do you like that?
I think that's pretty sensible, but then it also makes me feel self-conscious that I don't seem to be on a course to be having any daughters of my own, and now I'm worried that people aren't going to hold me properly accountable.
I'm just saying, my parlor game is, who do you want locked up? Ivanka and Jared and Jenna. That's it. I'd be sated. Everybody else can walk free. I want Ivanka, Jared, and Jenna locked up.
Yeah, well, you lost me a little bit there, but I understand the underlying sentiment, and I will leave it at that.
Zack Ford writes for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. Read him every day. Can you stand the line for 1 second, sir?
Of course.